आदाब, वेलकम टू अनदर लेक्चर ऑन आवर शेयर्ड पास्ट ऑर्गेनाइज्ड एंड ब्रॉट टू यू बाय अलीगढ़ सोसाइटी ऑफ हिस्ट्री एंड आर्कियोलॉजी, दैट इज आशा एंड गंगा जमुनी हेरिटेज. सिंस द लास्ट 5 months, वी हैव बीन योर कॉन्स्टेंट कंपेनियन ट्वाइस अ वीक, फ्राइडे एंड संडे. Ganga Jamuni has been connecting with you independent of us on Saturday as well. Our joint effort has been to focus on the past. Past as a joint venture between different Indian communities. Ganga Jamuni has focused on our culture, and we at Asha have tried to present before you historians and scholars of repute. Historians from around the world connected with us to share their works. In between, we have also presented before you our indigenous and local scholarship. To progress, we not only need big banner names, but also budding scholars with promising futures. To me, it is reassuring that our local talent too is contributing to our understanding of our past. In the past weeks, we have had quite a few scholars from Aligarh, from professors down to assistant professors, and I am proud to say each added something to our knowledge. Today, we have Dr. Ali Kazim with us. He has been a serious scholar since his MA days. I remember a three-day trip with him to Jaipur and Agra. While his classmates were dancing and singing in the long, arduous bus journey, Kazim was lost deep into a book which he was reading. Dr. Kazim started his career from Jamia Millia Islamia. After a brief stint there, he was absorbed at the Jawaharlal Nehru Memorial Fund, Teen Murti House, New Delhi, where he worked on Nehru papers in a major project led by Professor Mushirul Hasan. This stint of his exposed him to real research and ways to handle primary documents and sources. His own research is on a critical study of the role and achievements of Sayyid brothers. And he has contributed some papers on 18th and 19th century political and cultural history. Shi'i history and culture is also one of his interests. He has traveled a number of times to Iraq and Iran and has attended 4 international conferences there. He is one of the members of the Aligarh Society of History and Archaeology and has been a great support for these lectures. He has been bombarding most of the speakers with multiple questions. He is also a lucky survivor of the COVID menace. He literally escaped death by a hair's breadth. Congratulations, Kazim, for successfully defeating the virus. And welcome to this program as a speaker. Kazim will be speaking on literary and cultural efflorescence in an era of political disintegration, the 18th century India. Over to you, Dr. Kazim.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm fortunate to have been asked by Asha and Ganga Jamuni Tehzeeb to speak on something which is very close to my heart, which is basically the area of my research on which I have been working for the last several years, even during PhD and after my PhD, the 18th century India. In fact, the 18th century India is a very, very interesting and very exciting area. Apart from this, this 18th century first attracted my attention not from India per se, but then when I in my MA days and then in my PhD or all those things, I started to study the 18th century of the Islamic world, the medieval world empire. Then I saw several similarities in this dynamic period, the 18th century, which we call, which is just a era of pre-modern period, which is a pre-modern era for these medieval empires, Safavids, Ottomans, Uzbek Khanate, and the Mughal Empire. So that is why my interest got entangled with this area, this period of the 18th century in India. How we have to see the 18th century in India, because there is no one thing which can be categorically said about the 18th century. Several things, very many things happened sometime in an overlapping manner, sometime side by side. Several things have been taking place in the 18th century India. Like the most important thing is the decline of the Mughal Empire, such a huge empire of the medieval world, one of the greatest empires. With a very sound administrative structure, quote unquote centralized. People some say that some historians are of the view that it was not a centralized empire, but there is very strong evidence that it was a centralized empire. It was a wall to wall carpet, not a patchwork quilt, and that is a contentious issue. I don't need to enter into this issue. But then the decline of the Mughal Empire and the role of several elements. Its role of nobility, the role of economy, the role of the East India Company. Several things have been discussed threadbare in the 18th century, Indian history. And so is the case with the other four empires, which are also on the history of which I am very, I have a lot of interest. I have developed a lot of interest these days. That the same thing, several, more or less, many similar things were taking place, like the brush with modernity. 18th century is the period for the medieval world empire, which in which for the first time we are seeing a kind of the brush with modernity taking place. Not only the medieval world empire, but if you just go some thousand miles away, then Egypt is witnessing for the first time the interaction with the French, where Napoleon landed in Egypt in 1798-99. And after the departure of Napoleon, massive changes taking place in the Arab world. From Egypt to the whole Arab world, Muhammad Ali Pasha instituting so many reforms. So it was a kind of, so in this same way, this is the case for the Egypt, for in the case of Ottomans, we are witnessing the massive interaction with the modernity. In the same way, the interaction with the modernity is taking place in India in 18th century and how they are going to respond to it. And at the same time, the empire is very, very stout and sturdy and very, very colossal type of a structure. Mughal Empire was going to pieces. So these are the things which have to be taken into account before making a clear picture of the 18th century. What was the role of the economy? What kind of the decline in the economy was taking place? What was the role of the East India Company and the emergence of the autonomous state? These are the three broad things which happened at the same time, more or less at the same time, overlapping each other, sometimes taking place side by side. Like the formation of the autonomous states, rebel states, new states, several categorization is there. And how did the Northern India culture and society and the literature got affected by these things? Of course, there cannot be, it goes without saying, and it defies logic that if someone is saying that a centralized empire, Mughal Empire, the economy of the Mughal Empire in the 17th century was same that of the 18th century. 18th century witnessed so many devastations, so many conflicts, so many turmoils, upheavals, that you can't simply name it. You can't simply name it. It's very difficult to number them. So many things happened. If you go on speaking on the devastation and the pillage and the loot and plunder which took place in the northern India, that will take another lecture. But then the manner in which Delhi, the central India, the core Mughal region, Delhi Agra region, it bounced back. It made a comeback. It made a comeback several times. Like at one instance, of course, this, here I am concentrating on the. This is a notion that the economy has gone has gone for a toss. Of course, it has gone for a toss. The massive loot and plunder, but then the loot and plunder and the pillaging and then the massive devastation. Sometimes, if you go by the sources, then they have overplayed so many things, overemphasized so many things. Like the loot and plunder of Nadir Shah has been exaggerated so much. He took away a lot of things, but within 10 years, Delhi was back on the track. You see the production in Delhi taking place, the agriculture belt of Delhi again flourishing. Time and again, for 10 years, 20 years, there was an Ahmad Shah Abdali devastated North India every alternate year. His first attack took place in 1748 and he died in 1769, 20 years. So in a span of, within a gap of every 2 or 3 years, he would come to Northern India. Such was, but then still you will see the flourishing of Delhi. Delhi is taking a kind of the lead several times. Of course, the one thing which the at this point of time, we have to make a clear demarcation between one who is writing from what angle. Like the poets, the Ashraf people, those who are living in Delhi, they are feeling the heat. But then the power is also shifting from their hands. Now we are witnessing the emergence of several new groups in Delhi. Several new groups, never social group, traders, merchants, bankers, moneylenders, etc. They are ruling the roost in Delhi. They are having a field day in Delhi. And because we don't have account from that side, we have the mostly account from this side. Like poets, Sada, Mir, Dard, they all have been lamenting the state of the affairs in the Delhi region, in the core region. But the minute they will shift to the peripheral region, to the autonomous region, to the regions which emerged after the wake of the decline of the Mughal Empire, you will see they are praising these lives, the lives, their culture, their economy, the ostentatious life. But then some of the sensible men like me never liked Blockton. He migrated to one of the greatest, Khudai Sokhan. He lived a very long life. I think he was born in 1720 or 18 and he died in 1810. He lived age of around 88-89 years, in which he migrated to several parts of India. Not only he left Delhi once, he again came back, then he again left Delhi, then he again came back and finally left Delhi for good to Lucknow. But then in Lucknow, he saw, because he was a product of a culture in Delhi, which was entirely a different thing. He saw with his own eyes, and the ostentatious life, the kind of the very shallow kind of thing, the language which developed in the Lucknow, he never liked it. Never he could never fathom the Mukaffa, Masajja, and all those Persianization of Urdu which was taking place. He never liked it. That is why you will see at the end of his life, all his Diwan and all his Kulliyat, everything Vikramir, Ashar to mere hain, Awam Pasand, Khawas Pasand par meri guftugu Awam se hai. But all these things came to a knot when he said that Kharaba Delhi ka Lucknow se behtar tha, wahi Akash mar jata, Sara Seema na aata jaan. Very famous couplet, which was at the lips of everyone. This is the last, this is the conclusion. The life which he lived for such a long period. So he is giving a kind of a clean sheet to what happened in Delhi. He, after roaming around the whole in Northern India, and he even stayed with the Jats. Some of his patrons were the Jats. For 10 or 15 years, he stayed with the Jats in the Gulgaon region, in the region of Mewat region, under the patronage of when Delhi was devastated. But at the end of the day, this man is giving a great thing for Delhi. That wahi Akash mar jata, sara seema na aata jaan. I should have died there. What was the point? It was the biggest mistake of my life to have come to Lucknow. So this is the diffusion of the culture, the Mughal culture, in the in the autonomous region, in the independent region, the new states, was also not liked by some of the scholars. In case of Sodha, you will see that Sodha being having his background from Rafi Sodha, from a kind of a very elite group. He was the son of a well-to-do merchant. So he used to enjoy, he used to kind of the write satirical poetry. But then the pain which Mir is feeling at the destruction of Delhi and then the diffusion of the culture, of course he moved to Lucknow, he stayed there. So these things have to be, so there is not a one kind of a one mono causal explanation or a mono causal mono consequence for this the devastation of Delhi, decline of Delhi. There are several things. For one argument in favor of the resurgence of Delhi, for the in favor of the vibrancy of the Delhi culture in 17 at the time of Nadir Shah invasion, you will have hundreds of accounts which will negate all those things. Author of Murakkab Delhi is giving a such a glowing picture, such a brilliant portrayal of Delhi, as if Delhi is like some kind of the some kind of a culture which was in some Western countries going on. Everybody was happy. They were busying wars. Chhadi procession is going on, and then at one point in the one marketplace, someone is reciting a qasida, another place someone is reciting a hajj, and then there is someone who is reciting marsiya at the same time. He completely glossed over so many things which was happening because he never visited those areas, some areas which happened, which felt the heat, which felt the destruction and devastation in the wake of Nadir Shah invasion. He never visited it. So if someone bases the account, someone is trying to formulate the history of the northern India during the decline of the Mughal Empire, basing on the account of Murakkab Delhi of Dargah Quli Khan, because he came from Hyderabad. It was a new place opened for him in Delhi. Delhi was a kind of, even after so many turmoil, so many kind of the upheavals and upsurge, ups and down, Delhi was Delhi. The culture, the Shahjahanabad area and all those havelis and fountains, the Chaurahas, the Masjid, the Khanqahs, the several was taking place in Delhi. There were hundreds of dargahs, and the chhari procession was a unique thing. There are a lot of depiction of the chhari procession going on. So from this account, you can see an entirely a different picture of Delhi. But then if you see the poetic account, then they are very devastated. They are very perturbed. Sauda, Hatim, Mir Taqi Mir, Dard, they all are lamenting the way the elite, the Ashrafs are losing the grip on power every time. And they are lamenting the way the Ajlaf, the Arzals, these are the words which have been used freely. Because here I want to make my point to say something that these things have to be understood in a proper context. If Mir being such a, if you just study the ideas of Mir, the religious ideas, the so eclectic in his religious feeling, eclecticism, and then all those syncretism which was there in the religious thing. And he is talking about, he's angry that Sauda has taken into he has committed to make some ajlaf as a poet. He took some ajlaf under his guardianship to train him as a poet, and he's very angry with Sauda that if these ajlaf, these cobblers, blacksmiths, and then masons, and then those the vegetable vendors, if they are going to learn poetry, then who will do poetry? Yeah, these are the things. This is one Mir. And there is another Mir who says that Kashka Khaja, there may be a Kabka Tab Islam Kiya. Such a progressive thing. Mind boggling. Mir ke dino mazhab ka kya poochte ho usne to. Kashka Khaja, there may be a Kabka. Such a idea which is coming in the 18th century. So we have to understand 18th century from this perspective. There cannot be one determinant. If we base our argument simply on the economic determinism, then everything will be, we won't be able to see anything. It will kind of a, will be like, we'll be missing so many things. We are going to miss so many things. If you just, of course, economic decline, there is no, there can't be nowhere, by no stretch of imagination, ajara farming, revenue farming, which saps the vitality of the Mughal Empire. It started during the period of Jahadar Shah, continued during the period of Farrukh Sayar, took a rapacious form at the time of the Muhammad Shah. It can never be justified. No one can say that it was a kind of portfolio farming. It was a capitalist enterprise by no stretch of imagination. These are the some European terms, European things which we are going to. Ajara farming was an out and out exploitation of the peasants, where someone the land was given to the higher bidder. So exactly the same thing. If you are going to justify ajara farming, then the next step would be to justify what Warren Hastings and Cornwallis did in the permanent settlements. So when thousands of zamindars, thousands of landholders were evicted, land sub-infiltration, thousands, hundreds of intermediaries emerged who used to gain a lot from the field, and the without working on the field, they were earning a lot of money. So once you justify ajara farming, then there is next step would be to justify what Cornwallis did in the permanent settlement. This is kind of the polemics. And 18th century was also the age of the polemics. I'm just, because this things of the polemics, whether it was a period of decline or the period of growth, what was the kind of the economy, what was the kind of the society. So we have to be very clear that in economy, the economy of the 18th century cannot be made at par with the economy which preceded. We have enough account, we have enough statistical account, we have very strong, with valid primary sources that economy in the 17th century was, even now, during the period of Aurangzeb, when Jagirdari and Mansabdari system was feeling a crack, they were feeling the heat, and many things were crumbling. You know, a systemic failure was imminent, was writing on the wall, writing was clear on the wall, that the empire was not going to survive. But then still, the kind of the things, the economic stability, otherwise it was not possible for someone to away. That is a unique example that, and that someone, the man who was the most powerful emperor of India, he was not at the central government, he was not at the central power, he was not at the seat of power for the last 25 years. The life of this man, those people who say that no, there was a kind of a compromise between all those things, the local elements and local potentates and then local communities and the regional forces, it was a compromise or not an empire, then how come you justify the very sound functioning of the empire in northern India? Aurangzeb stayed in, he went to, I think he left Agra, Delhi in 1679 and never came back. The empire was running pretty well in northern India. There used to be a very, one example which is related to this topic is that when this man who was the founder of Darsan-e-Nizami, Nizamuddin, his father was murdered in the region of Sihali. Sihali is in the Awadh, very near to Barabanki and Awadh, Lucknow, very close to. And his father was murdered. And then this man and his uncle wrote a petition. It was sent to Aurangabad, the Maratha land where Aurangzeb was busy fighting against the Maratha. And the next day the order came that he will have to be given all those jagirs. A house was given in Lucknow, which was known as the Firangi Mahal. There's a Nizami and then all the Mullah Nizamuddin. So there are certain examples. Otherwise, how come the empire could not have survived 25 years? Without any kind of the, because the, all those things were functioning in a proper manner. The some of the core things of the empire, like the Jagirdari system and all those things were functioning. The crumbling in this empire took place, the cracks started to appear because of the Jagirdari crisis and the agrarian crisis. Several things happened. I don't need to go into the details of all those things. But then the economy cannot be. Someone is saying that, of course, the empire got disintegrated, political disintegration took place, several local states, independent states, autonomous states emerged in several parts of northern India. And they had their own administration on some place like in Awadh, according to historians, there is a growth. In Punjab, there was a kind of this stagnation. These are things independent regional studies, of course. But then in terms of culture and literature, there cannot be any no there there can't be any question that it grew, it witnessed massive progress, the in terms of literary production, in terms of book production, in terms of the madrasa education. Of course, it started with madrasa rahimia and then shawariullah. At that time, a new current in the Islamic world was taking had happened. He went to Medina under the came under the tutorship of great scholar in Medina, was the Maliki, Lama Kuddi, and then other person, two great scholars under whose guidance he studied all those things, Islamic faith, jurisprudence. He came back and wrote Hujjat Allah al-Baligha, in which he tried to synthesize Islam and the science. And very interesting book. Of course, there are many contradictions in book. Sometimes just in you read 10 pages, you will have 10 contradictions coming from his same on the one page is saying one thing, and the next page is contradicting the same thing. But then it was a landmark, the Shia Sunni polemic, because one very interesting thing that some of the very interesting and very exciting thing is taking place in this period also in 18th century, the dominance of the Usuli fiqh. Now, up till now, Usuli fiqh was at the back foot, was at the not at the forefront. Now you will see the emergence of the Usuli fiqh. The ascendancy of Usuli fiqh is taking place. Akbari is asked on the back because the state is being formed. The Shia state with Shia nobles. Of course, it was not a Shia. No, the term is very fallacious term to use the word term Shia state. The founder were the Shia. But then it had the support of several. They took the support of the local element, the talukdars and all those zamindars, and then the Taluis people and the region of Kaishta and Khatris. It was a compromise with massive number of Hindus, and the Sunnis also participated. Of course, since it was the ruling class, those who were at the head of Usuli, the Awadh state, they were the Shia, so kind of the Usuli fiqh was there. Usuli fiqh got a prominence. So it was a kind of a departure. Before that, there was a kind of in the Mughal period, and even before that, you will have so many, because Usuli fiqh is entirely a different thing from the Akhbaris. So they will have their own mosque, they are going to have their prayer, they are not going to go taqiyya. These all things were. So, of course, in Bengal, Murshid Quli Khan and then their successors. But then, it also led to a kind of the massive polemical discussion. Polemics started to take place. Massive polemics. This is the period when some people got alarmed that it was a kind of the period of Shia, kind of the resurgence. So massive tracts were written. People went on writing so many tracts, and the she also responded. It created a kind of the sectarian kind of the conflict. But then it is also being overplayed. Of course, books were written. The Raj literature also came up in response to one Tawfiyasna Ashriya. Dozens of Shi'is took up the project of refuting one chapter one by one. Someone would write the refutation of two chapters, someone would write the refutation of three chapters. So a kind of a, but then kind of the cooperation and the kind of the tolerance which was there in the Shia Sunni kind of the thing, except one or two accidents like in that case also, like the murder of Mazhar Jana Jana. He did not name the culprit. He knew the assassin, but he didn't name it. Of course, people thought that his murder was, but there is no very evidence, clear evidence that Najaf Khan was responsible. He sent the man to kill him. But because of his Sufi kind of thing, he didn't name the man. And Sadaq was a kind of a, who earlier wrote a very kind of a scathing, he made a scathing attack on Shah Abdullah and Shah Abdul Aziz. He wrote a kind of a marsiya for Mazhar Jana Jana. Something very unexpected at that time. If we have assumed that the 18th century was a period in which Hindus and Muslims, Shias and Sunnis, they were at each other's throat. No, it was not like that. This is something which is a colonial construct. If someone is trying to trace the history of communalism from the prehistory of colonialism from the 18th and 17th century, it defies logic. Of course, conflict used to take place. Conflict would take place. But then it did not have any political connotation. Conflict out of some kind of the rivalry, some kind of the clash of interest. But there were no political slogans and the political kind of the, like these political parties who in 19th and 20th century, they led the movement against, in the name of, whether it is Muslim League or Hindu Mahasabha. Nothing can equate. It is a kind of very far-fetched idea. To compare the what happened in 19th and 20th century in the name of colonialism to what happened in 18th century. Of course, Ahmedabad riot took place on the day of Holi. Shia Sunni conflict also used to take place during the days of Muharram. But there are hundreds of instances of thousands of instances where massive participation of Sunnis and Hindus took place. Hindus participated in Muslim festivals, Muslim participated in Hindu festivals. There is no need to, there are hundreds, thousands, dozens of works have been done on this thing. So the development in the culture and the literature was the hallmark of this period. No one can deny that the what we are witnessing in terms of there are several kind of the shared things, shared legacy, which were carried forward till in the 19th century, and we narrated it in the 20th century. These all things are the legacy of the 18th century. The manner in which Urdu, the manner in which the Persian Urdu got a prominence, it became a lingua franca for such a huge mass for the northern Indian people. The development of Urdu is another story. There are several theories how with the coming of, there are several things that how with the coming of one man, if someone is to be asked that what is the one of the greatest turning point in the development of Urdu, everybody would say that Wali Gujarati traveled to India and then he converted the whole northern India to be Urdu lover. But it was not like that. There was a foundation for the Rekhta, Hindavi, Urdu that has already taken place. Of course, the coming of Ali Dakkani to Delhi and the way he managed to convince poets who were in hordes in Delhi to write in Urdu. We will see the manner in which he write. But the next one thing is that this is one of the forward-looking thing, but the backward-looking thing is that how Hindavi, which is Urdu also, how Persian words were deliberately, the local words were, the language was rid of the local words, local dialects, several local words were there. So even if it be a Urdu, it has to be a Persianized Urdu. That created a kind of, here the development of Urdu was stuck. Because in the beginning, the development of Urdu in northern India and the way these poets, five or six big poets, Hatim, Khane Arzu, Sauda, Dard, Jane Jana, Mir, of course, the manner in which they propagated the poetry, the way they wrote their poetry, the Ghazal, Masnavi, Dastan, all those things which got all the genre became a kind of a, they after having taken a lot of inspiration from the Persian, a kind of the revival of these things too. It could be, not a comparison could be made, but then the manner in which the revival of a local Persian language took place in the 8th and 9th century Iran, which is known as Shubia movement, when the Arabs were the Persian people who had been shocked, it was a shock and awe for them to have been subjugated by the Arabs. They remained dormant for 200 and 300 years and then they started to again write in Persian. And get the foundation of Persian, you know, New Persian, Middle Persian. In the same way, you will see the local language. It was not like that, there was no local language was there. They were in the awe of Persians. The Turks who came to India, they were the Persianized Turks. The Mughals, they would also speak Persian in the public. There was the Persianization thing. So the manner in which there was a the whole Northern India was under the, so all those regional things had been, of course they were there. It was not like that, like after the Arab conquest, the Iranians started to, they stopped speaking Persian. They would not publish it. They would not be, they would try to be Persian speaking in their houses, in their close area. But in the publicly, they would be, but then later on, 3 years, like 200 years, you see a movement. The same way you see the regional variation, the regional assertion led to the development of not only Urdu, but you will see here the Gujarati, Uriya, Sindhi, Punjabi, and whatnot. Just you, one can see any research or good book on the, written on the 18th century linguistics. Then you will come across lingual history that how not only Urdu, several other languages, because the manner in which the Mughal Empire was crumbling, the nobility and the upper class of the elite nobility, the ruling class, they had been sidelined, and the manner in which the local elements like these money lenders and then vegetable vendors, money lenders, then merchants, traders, entrepreneurs, they now opted for Urdu. So there was a kind of the massive patronage being given to the poets and the scholars. But those who were not satisfied in Delhi, they left Delhi. So you see the emergence of very interesting language centers in Farrukhabad, in Lucknow, in Murshidabad. People migrated in hordes. So in terms of literary development, in terms of culture, in terms of the flourishing of so many kind of the composite things, 18th century is interesting, very exciting. It cannot be simply said that it was a period in which Hindus and Muslims, they would be fighting. There was a kind of a mutually rivalry, and they made a mutually exclusive group. They were antagonistic to each other. They were also cooperating, like in the same manner in which, like the warfare, in terms of warfare, we see that there is an image which is being deliberately and with a very malified intention, it is inculcated that it was a period in which massive warfare was taking place. Destruction was, of course, destruction would take place, but then war at that time was not as devastating as it has happened in the wake of the Second World War. Even the First World War was not as much devastating. The non-combatants started to be killed in the Second World War. In the First World War, it was basically those who were the combatants, who were only the combatants, who would be killed, because there was no air bombing. There was no bomb being dropped from the airplane in the First World War. So the war was not that devastating. And according to very eminent historians, I like this sentence very much, and I also try to repeat it again and again in my class, that the picture of the 18th century India is not of the war and conquest and all those plundering taking place. At the side by side, a war is taking place, and at the very next side, there is a peasant who is plowing his field. Two things are going side by side. A war is going on, and on the just very close to it, a peasant is plowing his field. So the dominant picture of the 18th century is not of war and all those sectarian and the communal things which is taking place, which is propagated by. So we have to be very clear in this thing. The 18th century, the political disintegration, and the effervescence of the culture and literature. And that has to be taken into account because the sources are, we have to take the help of the sources. We can't say anything out of nowhere. If we have Muraqqai Delhi, then we have Siyarul Mutaakhirin also. If someone is going to just write to conceive a picture of Northern India by reading Muraqqai Delhi, Muraqqai Delhi by Dargah Quli Khan, then he has to take help. He was a man who came and who traveled, a very learned noble of Nizamul Mulk, who came with him during the Battle of Karnal when he came to India. He came to northern part of India, Nizamul Mulk Asafjah. He saw it. then we will have to also study Sarul Mudakhirin, Ghulam Hussain Tabatabai. What a devastating picture he has written. He has shown how the Northern India, because his family, and he, I think he also migrated to, he was born in Patna, then sometimes he was in Delhi also, then finally I think I remember he migrated to Murshidabad. So this is one of the very interesting source for us. We take the help of Sayyidul Mutakhirin to come to a very kind of a definitive conclusion of this. But in the second half of the 18th century, you will come across Masir Umara being written by Shamsabdala Shainavaskam. He's going a very different picture of the 19th century, later part of the second half of the 18th century. So from who is saying, from what perspective, from what vantage point, who is saying that is also to be taken into account. You can't simply draw a picture of a particular era, because it is not something which is related to one year or 2 years or a couple of years. It's a whole century of a pre-modern India. Not only, this is a scenario everywhere. In Ottoman Empire, in Safavid Empire, you will see what is happening in Safavid Empire at the same time. The same thing happening, the Safavids are declining, the massive fissures in the structure of Safavids have been taking place. Nadir Shah is coming to power. But this is also a place where, this is also the period in which massive kind of the literary and cultural works are also being produced. Literary works are being produced. Culture is has got a fillip. A massive fillip to the culture is also taking place. In Ottoman Empire, the same thing happening. After the death of Suleiman, he died in 1666. Then just a few years later, then you just 18th century started. And you just see what is happening in Ottoman Empire. Massive kind of the interaction with the Europeans and all those things. The reform process is taking place in Ottoman Empire. So the Tanzimat, the whole set of reforms taking place. So 18th century is a very, this is why when I was asked to choose this topic, these all things just jumbled up in my mind. How to see this thing, this period? Just by what is happening, you can't simply say that Mr. X, Mr. Y, Jahandar Shah was wrong on Farooq Sher was right, and Sayyid brother did some commendable things. The period of the first half, and Sayyid brothers for 6 or 7 years, they did some marvelous things. Of course, they had no other option but to depose the emperor. Because if he had not deposed them, then the emperor was conspiring. He made two or three very clear attempts to get rid of Sayyid brothers. Almost, he had almost killed him. He survived because of his courage and all those his manipulation. When Hussain Ali Khan left for Deccan, express communication was sent to Alim Khan, the deputy governor in Deccan, that look, this man is going, first kill him, you will be rewarded. That paper was leaked. The same thing happened with Ajit Singh. Ajit Singh, who was the father-in-law of Farooq Sher. He was in secret communication with Ajit Singh to finish both his brothers. These are kind of, so they didn't have any option. I'm not justifying the role of Sher brothers, but then the manner in which they tried to broad-base the administration, no one can deny it. No one can. There cannot be any doubt that the broad-basing, because he knew that much water has flown down the river, things have changed. Now India is not the India of 17th century. Now the Jats, Bundelas, Marathas, Sikhs, they all have to be accommodated. Their genuine demands will have to be met. You can't simply, because Sayyid brothers, their forefathers, their ancestors, they had served under Aurangzeb, they had seen that it was humanly impossible to bring such a recalcitrant area, Deccan, by such a powerful emperor after having stayed there for 25 years under the control. It was not possible. It did not happen. Despite the best effort, best artillery, best army, and whatnot, Aurangzeb invested everything. You just read the last 25 years around there. Mind-boggling. This old man was running from this place to that place. The energy which Aurangzeb had, and that energy was only shown by Timur. These are the two men who had that amount of energy at that advanced age, at that advanced age, it still surprises me what kind of energy they had. But still, he died as a frustrated man. The whole Maratha was, he killed Chambaji, his target, he got his target, he was cut down to pieces. But what was the next thing? The remedy turned out to be what was then the disease. So now Sayyid brothers Hussain Ali Abdullah Khan, they had understood this fact that now let us accommodate them. But then the manner in which they did, they were stepped those limits in which they killed the emperor. And one of the unique thing which is I don't know which happened. It happened because of there are two things which we do. One, we do out of weakness. One, we do out of our strength. I don't know because of weakness or the strength they did, but they did very marvelous thing. That the daughter of Ajit Singh, who was married to Farrukh Sher, and was converted to Islam. Once Farrukh Sher died, was killed. The same daughter, the wife of Farrukh Sher, was allowed to renounce the religion Islam, and she was allowed to go with Ajit Singh. This is the first and unique instance. I don't, because the London audience might point out some other instance, but this period in which, in a willing manner, with the consent of the state, a Hindu princess having converted to Islam was allowed to again revert back to her religion and allowed a safe passage. And that is the murtad. And in terms of Sharia, murtad is bound to die. So these are the steps of Sayyid brothers. The manner they did away with Jazia. So these are the things. Well, because they knew these things. They were the Indian Muslims. And all the Iranis and Turanis, they ganged right up against him. The religion of Islam in danger was raised. But the interesting thing is that the minute Sayyids are killed, the same Islam in danger raised by Nizam ul Haq was met with a lot of opposition. And this man had to leave Delhi. Nizam ul Haq wanted to reform the administration, who had come all the way from Deccan after the killing of Sayyid brothers. He wanted to revive the empire, and a fatwa was also brought from Makkah by Inayatullah Khan Kashmiri of imposing the jizya. All those things were met with massive resistance. And this man had to go out of Delhi. And the same man who was trying to build up the movement against the whole kind of the movement against Sayyid brothers, that they were making a compromise with Maratha. The minute Nizam ul Mulk went to Maratha land in 1724, he made several compromises with Marathas. So these were the matter of political. Here, no amount of religion and the kind of the sectarian. That is the problem which we face, that we in fact sometimes bring the matter of religion on a very exaggerated limit. Of course, things happen, but the political affiliation, the one-to-one contact, personal affiliations have more thing to do rather than these religious things. If we start to emphasize the religious things, then every conflict we will have to invent a religious angle. The Shia-Sunni polemics in the 18th century, which generated a lot of heat, but then it also generated a lot of light also. Many till now unexplored sources of Shi and Sunni, they were studied for this purpose. This was a good thing. Many kind of the things, unexplored things. Of course, it created a lot of debate and kind of the tension also. But then the manner in which the Shi ulama and the Sunni ulama, they created a kind of it. And the role of the Sufis, this is the period in which the massive kind of the resurgence of the Chishti Silsila is taking place. Silsila, which had almost finished in Delhi and the areas around it. It made a massive comeback in the 18th century with Shah Fakhruddin, Kalimullah, and Shah Nizamuddin. The Khanqahs had been teeming with bustling with people's old ceremonies. At the one point of one place, someone is reciting Marsiya, another place, a woman is selling the tablet, Turbe, Sajdaga, saying that it has been brought from Karbala. And at the other place, some kind of a Hindu yogi is performing some art. So this is also the kind of the, and this thing we inherited in the 19th century. We cannot study in 19 because in the 19th century, with the coming of the, after 1803, when the control of Delhi and the control of the Mughal Empire was completely in the hand of the Mughals, Shah Alam came under the control of the British Company, East India Company, then it was a kind of a massive break, 1803, in which the control of Emperor Shah Alam, he was brought under the complete control of the East India Company from Sindhias, having snatched it from Sindhia. So here is a matter. Now the policy of all those things which became a kind of, they created a kind of a new thing. 20 and 30 years later, you will see the census, all those things, the kind of the colonial things regarding these history writing, showing the medieval period as a kind of the period in which massive killing of Shias by Aurangzeb and the killing of Hindus by Muslim rulers started. This was shown to be a kind of a dominant language of the medieval period. Several books were written. So many things we just copy in colonial terms. We just imitate what the colonial writers had wanted to would have us believe. Those colonial writers would have us believe, we have believed it without questioning it. So the 18th century, the period I wanted to just discuss with you, a kind of a broad thing, because there is not something which can be just in terms of literature and language and even one thing, Marsiya Nigari, in terms of Marsiya Nigari, there's Dastan Goi, then several things going on. Marsiya Nigari, Dastan Goi. There are several genres which took massive shape. Saraba Nigari, historians of drug, Professor Muhammad Umar had done marvelous work on the urban culture of 18th century, in which he has given an account of all those things which day-to-day life taking place. But then beneath all those surface, there was a tension, there was a conflict going on. But Delhi having a resurgence, having the capacity to bounce back, it bounced back. Of course, Nadir Shah came, it plundered, but then we have evidence that Delhi bound back. The production level lead up to the Nadir Shah invasion. Just imagine 10, 20 years, Ahmad Shah Abdali ravaged whole northern India. So much so that there is a saying in Punjab, like when we say that in our daily day-to-day life, if we cook something extra in our house when there was no refrigerator and fridge, then we would say that let us finish it, otherwise it would be ruined. We'll have to throw it. So the expression, the saying in Punjab is still that, Khata Pita Laita Baki Ahmad Shah Da, let us finish. Otherwise Ahmad Shah would come and loot it away. Loot them. That is still there in Punjab. In terms of what they want to say, that let us finish the food which has been prepared. Let us finish it. Don't put, otherwise it will be wasted. It will be given to the dogs and animals. So they still say in Punjab, Khata Pita Laita Baki Ahmad Shah Da. Just have it, otherwise Ahmad Shah would come. So we can imagine the northern India being plundered by Nadir Shah in 1748, from 1748 to 1769. And one thing I also want to make it clear, that the Mughal army, the nobility, the immorality of the quote-unquote nobility, the massive kind of the aishwaram and the lavish lifestyle of the nobility, which is being attributed to the decline of the Mughal Empire, it also has been refuted by historians. The artillery, the otherwise, how come in 1748, one of the very of the medieval world, that is the artillery, which was basically the artillery of Nadir Shah. After the death of Nadir Shah, the whole artillery, the whole army came under the control of Ahmad Shah Abdali. And that artillery, which came in battle of 1748 Manipur, this artillery was cut to pieces. The Mughal army ran them down. So if someone is of the view that because of the lack in artillery and because of the lack of topkhane, we suffered. But then how could someone match the artillery of Nadir Shah? Nadir Shah had a huge artillery. And the same artillery came into the possession of Ahmad Shah Abdali. And Nadir Shah is one of the, according to one historian, I am just missing the name of that person, he is one of the most powerful conquerors to have ever ran down the area of Khorasan, ran over the area of Khorasan, most powerful conqueror. And his general Ahmad Shah Abdali was defeated in the Battle of Manupur. So till Muhammad Shah, things were not as bad as some people would make us believe. But then the disintegration, political disintegration, which had taken place, which had started after the death of Aurangzeb, it was moving in a very fast manner. Regional forces, regional kind of the local forces, the power shift from the elite Ashraf to the lower class of people, it created a lot of problem. The wealth changed hands, the account of the Ashraf, they show a kind of a very, they are very perturbed about the development of all those things, of the power in the hands of those Ajjal. But then these elements also grew, and they had their own predilection. They never wanted to invest money in poetry. So just on the account of, if someone is writing the history of 18th century India, on the account of some poets, on the kulliyat of Mir Sauda and Hatim and Khan-e-Arzu and then all those things, he will also be missing some point. So a holistic kind of the, and if someone is very possessed, very obsessed about the economic determinism, economic angle, he will also won't be able to exactly draw a picture. So a picture of 18th century Delhi has to be drawn, has to be sketched after having taken into account several things, so many things. And that is what I wanted to share with you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kazim. Really, it was a very good, explanation of what actually 18th century was. 18th century has been, as you rightly pointed out, a very misunderstood century. It has been variously interpreted. It has been tried to say that it was the Dark Ages in India. It was not only the political decline, but an all-round decline which took place. Then there were others who tried to claim that there was no decline because there was no empire. There would be a decline only and only if there had been an empire, and Mughal Empire was no empire at all. So everything was hunky-dory. And then what was happening? Growth was happening during this period. Now, as you pointed out today, that there is some truth in both the arguments. Whether it is the Aligarh school which keeps on lamenting the 18th century basically as a period of decline, and the other group keeps on celebrating 18th century as the period of efflorescence, your lecture tried to balance the situation by putting everything into perspective, that yes, there was a political decline, but apart from the politics, there are other things which matter in life, the culture, the literature, and these were the things which we find developing throughout the 18th century. Let us take a few questions which have been asked. I presume that there are some. Ali Haider has asked a question. Sir, did Sayyid Brothers play a major role in saving the Mughal Empire from collapsing? And was changing of political structure of Mughal Empire from absolute monarchy to oligarchy a good idea and need of the time? There are two questions, in fact.
Sayyid Brothers, in fact, they played it. They wanted to, because if you, there are two collections of letters which have been written by Sayyid Brothers, and it has been compiled by his secretary Bal Mukund Mehta, Bal Mukund Nama, and then there is an Ajaibul Afaq, in which he very clearly says that that he was of the view that Mughal Empire could be sustained, it can survive only if the local elements, these Jats, Marathas, and these people, Sikhs, they are incorporated in the functioning of the empire. The empire has to be broad-based. There is no option other than this, because the preceding 25 or 30 years had clearly shown that it was a futile experiment by Aurangzeb to subdue the Maratha. Nothing happened. Sikhs came back to square one at the time of the death. Then this man was dying in 1707. He had almost planned to come back to Delhi. Yet the arrangements have been made. He died. He was become at because of the advanced age. He died because of all those diseases which he was suffering from. Otherwise, he had made a complete. He had commanded in Delhi, and all those routes had been cleared. He wanted to come back to Delhi. All these things preparation had been made. So the Sayyid brothers who had seen those areas, the Hindustani, because they were the leader of the Indian factions, the Indian Muslim Shahzadat, those who had migrated to India several centuries earlier, and then they had become Indianized. So they had known this thing that the only way to save the empire, and that is then why they made a pact with even before Sayyid brothers, Zulfiqar Khan. Sayyid brothers, in fact, of course they did not see eye to eye. The Sayyid brothers killed Zulfiqar Khan, but then in terms of policy, Zulfiqar Khan and Sayyid brothers, they were on the same plane. Zulfiqar Khan, the leader of the Irani faction, he had almost a deal with Shah, but then some misunderstanding happened, and this man, this deal was aborted midway, just before the death of Aurangzeb. So the manner in which they wanted to kind of strike a balance with, to kind of compromise with these Marathas, their long demand of Chauth and Sabdash Mukhi, these all things were met in 1717 by Hussain Ali Khan in Deccan. And he came to Delhi to get the treaty signed, ratified. So that is very much clear that according to them, these two brothers, of course they wanted to exercise the power. The matter of Wizarat was very important at that time. The Wazir had acquired a very strong influence, not only in India, but in the Ottoman Empire and in other areas also. The Wazirat had become a very big thing in Ottoman Empire also at this time. People would fight and die for the Wizarat, because those faction who was having the Wizarat, they would control all the leverage of power. The levers of power would be in their hands. So one thing is clear. That is that by changing the political structure from absolute monarchy to oligarchy, it's very difficult to say exactly, because after deposing the Farrukh Syar and then finally killing him, and then making the two other princes ascend the throne, and then both died, and then finally Muhammad Shah, they did not claim the Timuri's crown. They could have done so, but then the absolute kind of the thing, the sovereignty of the sovereign power which was there in the Timuri's thing, the kind of this thing that Timuri's was, only a Timuri's could be the could own the crown of India. That was there. They could not. Otherwise, if they had, of course, they wanted the Timuri's crown to be following their dictate. These two brothers, and the manner in which they tried to concentrate the powers in their own hands, and finally both started to fight against each other. So these things are also to be taken into account. But then they tried to follow a path which was started by Zulfiqar Khan. The abolition of Sharia, broad-basing of the administration, bringing diverse sections of the Mughal Empire, the difference of nobility and all those people into the administration. That was a good thing on their part. They failed, that is a different thing.
Okay, the next question, please. I think there's a question by Mirza Hasnain. Sir, what were the literary contributions of Emperor Shah Alam II and Aurangzeb's son Azam Shah? And do we find any poems or poetry written during this period that talks about rejuvenating the strength of Mughal political power once again?
Of course, Shah Alam wrote. Shah Alam, after having been, because he was, his eyes were taken out, he had a very kind of long period from 1759 to 1806, in which he was used like a shuttlecock. From sometimes he was in Allahabad, sometimes he was in Delhi, but then the life he lived, sometimes a very pain life of a very pauper, quite a pauper, when he was not able to pay some money to his trumpeters, and trumpeters were fighting against him, was cursing him that you are a king of Hindustan, or you are not able to pay me this much of money. So he lived a very kind of he had a very chikat career. He saw so many things. So he was also a great poet, Shah Alam. Some of his poetry is there in some of the books I've gone through, because I don't know exactly what wrote he, but he wrote two or three very important poems and others depicting his very sad state of affairs, the sordid state which he was undergoing. He wrote it. It is there in, if you have the access to the book, then there is a book on the 18th century based on the second half of the 18th century, written by Ishrat Haq and then Muhammad Umar. They have written there his poems and all those, Shah Alam. About Aurangzeb's sons, Azam Shah, I exactly don't know, but this, all I know about Azam is that he was a kind of a very eccentric kind of a very mercurial man. About which Aurangzeb would say that he is too salty. Aurangzeb would say two things about his two sons. Bahadur Shah first, which is Muazzam, that he is saltless. And for Azam, he would say that he is too salty. He would react on everything. He would go on fighting any kind of thing which is not, which something which happened, which took place, which was not to his liking. He would justly jump to things, he would hit the roof. This kind of the man Azam was. The poem he composed, I don't know. Because all I know about Azam is that he was, and he lost the battle because of his hard-headed attitude. He was so hard-headed, he was so kind of rigid in the attitude that he did not take the advice of any of his commanders. That is why at the time of the Battle of Jaju, most of the military, because Bahadur Shah was, when he came to fight for the Mughal throne, he was coming from Jamrud near Peshawar. Whereas Azam had all the paraphernalia, all the commanders, resources of Aurangzeb left in Aurangabad. He had the support of some of the brilliant commanders of Aurangzeb. But then by the time he was reaching up to the central India, Madhya Pradesh and Malwa region, almost all of them had deserted him because of his arrogant behavior. And his arrogant behavior was also very, and his violent behavior was not liked by Aurangzeb also, that at the time of his death, Aurangzeb said that he is an unchained lion. Let's take him away from us, me. Aurangzeb was of the view. Aurangzeb wanted Kambaksh to be near to him because he was the child who was born at the age when Aurangzeb was 72. Kambaksh were born. Aurangzeb liked Kambaksh very much. And he had written in which he said that he did to the nobles that in the case of the war of succession which was going to take place, you please support Kambaksh. Azam was very hot-headed, but then he was also very close to some kind of a Sufi. For his poetry, I exactly don't know Azam.
Dr. Kazim, I think, if I remember correctly, Aurangzeb also had a son who died probably along with Aurangzeb or soon after him. Who was well versed in the art of singing and dancing, and he also patronized a number of singers. The spirit of the question is that these princes did contribute in a way to the development of culture during that period, right? Catherine Scofield has given in one of her articles, I am forgetting the name of this particular prince, who says that he didn't survive Aurangzeb, but he was a very good performer himself, and one of those who was patronizing these soft arts like music and dance. Well, Hasan Aziz has a question. Sir Aziz says, sir, do we see the rise of communalism during this period of political disintegration during the 18th century? And would it be correct to trace the political idea of Pakistan movement to Shah Wali Ullah?
As far as the rise of communalism is concerned, the communalism per se, the modern definition of communalism cannot be transported to the 18th century. We can't simply define 18th century in terms of the modern day definition of communalism. Some historians, they are willing to, they have done some massive research, some very good papers have been published in which the prehistory of communalism has been traced to the 18th century. But the riots which happened, several riots took place in Ahmedabad. So one of the riots have been, of Ahmedabad has been very, very brilliantly, very, very kind of very crisp manner has been written by, paper has been written by Professor Najaf Haider, I think, in a seminar he read the title of the paper, the book is Living Together Separately, in which the riot of Ahmedabad has been discussed very nicely by Professor Najaf Haider. In the same way, several riots took place, but the political connotation and these political slogans, all those symbols of political symbols, which are right now used, which were used at the time of the partition, before partition, at the time of the growth of communalism under the Hindi Devanagari movement and cow slaughter. These are the three things on which the communalism, modern day communalism revolved. These things were absent. Of course, the fight took place, but then there was in a kind of organized kind of the riots going to take place. You know, organized destruction of the property of a particular community, very organized kind of the killing, some kind of the massacre. Violence, rebel rousers would be there, violence would be there. There are kind of the innocent killing would also take place. But then the state would interfere in a very, state won't be a party to all those things, like playing one forces with against another. So it is not, I think, tenable to say that rise of communism could be traced from the political decision. It is entirely two different things. As far as the idea of Pakistan is concerned, so also tracing the idea of Pakistan to Shah Wali Ullah's period is, I think, he was born in 1701 or 2 and then died in 1763. So just 200 years before, I don't think that political, Shah Wali Ullah, in terms of the Darul Halb and Darul Islam, there is one thing very clear, that he said that India has become a Darul Halb, and his son also tried to formulate these things in a more concrete manner, Shah Abdul Aziz, Darul Harb and Darul Islam. But then he was talking about Darul Harb in the sense that India had been subjugated by the British, not by the Marathas. He did not have anything much to say against the Marathas. Because the Marathas had, Marathas had, in totality, several things, they had completely copied the Mughal paraphernalia, Mughal etiquette, court culture, everything. Not only Marathas, but even the salutation and all those things. So, Shah Wali Ullah and Shah Abdul Aziz had, in fact, this idea of Darul Halb. But then to trace the idea of Pakistan to Shah Wali Ullah is, to trace the idea of Pakistan to Sir Sayyid is not enable. There is a much fashion to trace the origin of Pakistan in Sir Sayyid's movement. Sir Sayyid, the way Sir Sayyid said that Hindus and Muslims have to compete. This is a very bogus argument. So if Sir Sayyid came he blamed for Pakistan, then how come Shah Wali Ullah? I don't think that it is a very far-fetched.
Dr. Kazim is quite right in both the things. I'll just very briefly add to what he has said. There are three articles which I know of which have been written on riots and communal tensions during the Mughal period, tracing them to the Mughal period, to the 17th or late 17th century. One of the famous articles which tries to argue that to be the case is by Christopher Bailey. Christopher Bailey had tried to argue that the roots of the modern tensions, communal tensions and sectarian tensions, can be traced back to the Mughal period. Now, way back, I don't remember the year when it was, but definitely, if I remember correctly, it was the late 20th century when the Indian History Congress was held at Amritsar. And there, in one of the symposiums at Amritsar, where three papers are three separate papers are presented as a in the symposium. The paper which was read out by me was on this very particular topic, where I tried to contest the view of Christopher Bailey and tried to argue that riots can in no way be traced back to the 17th century, or for that matter, to early part of the 18th century. It is only and only afterwards, even in fact, whether it is the shoe sellers riots or riots which took place in Ahmedabad, or for that matter, in certain other cities of Delhi, all those of Gujarat, they were the riots where on the one hand were the shopkeepers, on the other hand were the Mughal officers, the petty officers of the state, and the state issued orders to punish the officials and protect the shopkeepers who were non-Muslims. So that way, I mean, even if there was some, clash where apparently there were people of one religion on one side, people of other religion on the other side, but the state openly came out in support of those who had been suffering. And in both the cases, in Delhi as well as in Ahmedabad, it was the oppressed non-Muslims who were supported by the state. Now, I would also like to add, and Najaf Haider had then ultimately presented his article, the one you are referring, which has recently been published on shoe sellers, right? It's a very beautiful article which Najaf has actually gone on to show that what was the actual position. Now, as far as trying to trace back the origins of Pakistan is concerned, I am sorry. Everyone tries to project back the concept of Pakistan somewhere before Muhammad Ali Jinnah. Kisi surat se wo Jinnah se pehle trace kar do, bahut din se chala aa raha tha. Sheikh Ahmad Sarani, you see, he's talked about Darul Harb and Darul Islam. He was the person who talked about kuffars and the Muslims. He was the original person. Others pointed out it was Shah Waliullah. In fact, not only poor Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, poor Allama Iqbal has also been accused of being a person who came up with this idea. The fact is that even after Pakistan came into existence, poor Muhammad Ali Jinnah was not sure whether it was a permanent thing or not, because he was till the end wishing his property to be safe and to be returned back to him, although he had left the country. So it is something which I think should not be paid attention to. This is just theories which are being tried to show that there was some pre-modern thinking going into the Pakistan movement, whereas there was done. Let us come to the next question.
One thing I would like to add, that there is a one fantastic idea also, which traces the origin of Pakistan to the 8th century. Ishtiaq Hussain Qureshi said that the home of history, the day Muhammad bin Qasim landed is in.
I mean, I am Qureshi had become a joker, in fact, after of some time. I mean, fantastic theories he had given in some of his books. The next question is by Bilal Balik. Do you suggest a book which encompasses all the effluences in the era of political disintegration during the 18th century?
Recently, 3 or 4 years back, my batchmate and my friend, Professor Tabir Kalam, has written a book. It has been published in from Primus. You just type the name of Tawik Lam. He has written on this thing, a very fine book, which has been published by Primus. He's a professor in BHU. And then all the political disintegration and the fluorescence in cultural literature and all those things. So that is, I think, a good book. A very 150, 60 pages book. You can go through it. But there are other books, very thick book, like Muhammad Umar has also written 3 books in which you can go on. But if you want to go for deep thing, then go for Muhammad Umar. Professor Muhammad Umar, he has written 3 books. But for in a short time, span of time, if you want to have an idea of the 18th century, its efflorescence and political disintegration, then go through Dr. Tawik Lam's book.
I mean, I would add to that probably all of us have access to Shodh Ganga these days. Before even Tabir Karam wrote his work, there was yet another work which was done on 18th century Delhi, where all these things were taken up, and that was by Ataullah, who teaches in Delhi University. Unfortunately, he failed to get his work published, but it is a remarkable take on this particular thing, where he not only deals with the city of Delhi during the 18th century, but also takes into account other aspects. So, and that work is now easily available on Shodh Ganga. So I would suggest, Bilal, that please go through all these works which are in fact available.
The same book is there.
Sagnik Sarkar, what was the cultural influence of the rise of Mirza Najaf Khan in the late 1770s as a prominent power center in Delhi, considering it was also a period of relative stability?
In fact, Najaf Khan is a very interesting figure for me. Two figures, one in the first half of the 17th century, another in the second half of the 2nd century. One is a Turani, another is a Irani. One is a staunch Sunni, another is a staunch Shia. These both the figures, Nizam Mulk and Najaf Khan. These are the two figures who somehow, in a very well-intentioned manner, they wanted to save the empire. They did everything possible, but they did not succeed. Nizam Mulk had to leave Delhi in the second decade of the 20th century, in the first half of the 2nd century, in 1720s. He came back. He wanted to institute an inquiry in the Jagir. He wanted to reform the whole Jagir system, which was crumbling. But then, in the face of massive opposition, he had to leave. So this man, Nizam Mulk Asafjah, he had some kind of good plan for the Mughal Empire. That is what I feel. And time and again, he came back to Delhi to bring back to salvage the Mughal Empire from the deep kind of the thing, deep drain which has gone into. In the same, in the second half of the 18th century, this man Najaf Khan, he also, so long as he was alive, from 1772 to I think 1782, he was the alum, and so long as he was alive, he tried to bring back the glory of the Mughal Empire, because according to many historians, he was the last Iranian warrior, Iranian general to have got such a prominence in India. And in terms of the stability of the empire, so long as he was alive, Jat, Sikhs, Maratha, he used to keep them at arm's length. And he was in a position to do so because of his warrior nature, because of his good military capability. That is the reason why Shah Alam, the most very stable period, and the great protection which Shah Alam used to feel, that was the period of his power, was Wazarat. So the role of Mirza Najaf Khan cannot be undermined. For 10 years, if he had survived for more years, he had a very short time to institute his plan and all those, to implement his plan. But if he had survived, then it is a hypothetical question, then we don't know what would happen. He was, many things were set right during his period. And then of course, this is from 1739-37, from the battle of 1737-38, from the battle of Karnal till 1772, 1782, this period of 10 years was the most stable period. The stability and the resurgence, the bouncing back of Delhi to its earlier days, which most of the historians talk about, it is attributed to this period. So the loot and plundering and all those, because by that time Ahmad Shah Abdali was also was gone. Ahmad Shah was gone in 1769, and he from 1772 to 82. So of course there is no question about Mirza Najaf Khan's credential. The blame of the allegation of sectarianism, very orthodox, that he could not come out of it. There are a good number of historians who believe that the man who was sent to kill Mirza Mazhar Jane Jana, that was on his payroll. But there is no clear evidence. According to Athar Abbas and those historians who have worked on the primary sources, they don't implicate him. But then these are one of the things. But sectarianism was attributed of being some kind of the typical sectarian Iranian novel.
Let's have the next question, please. Again, I think there is a question by Sagnik Sarkar. The Rohilas are largely perceived as savage warlords, especially Qudsi Ghulam Qadir's reign of terror in the Shah-e-Molla. Do we see any cultural influence of their supremacy in the Ganga Jamuna Doab, especially considering the rich cultural repository of the Rohila Rampur state?
Rohila's period and then the period of Ghulam Qadir is a kind of a big blot. We cannot be forgiven the manner in which he dealt with the Mughal princes and all those things, the manner in which the treatment being meted out to the Mughal princes. It's a very dark period of the Mughal history. But then setting aside Ghulam Qadir, then the Rohilas, this is also one of the examples how some regional powers started to give a kind of a very of a good governance in the region of Rohilas. We come across many centers were formed, the production increased, the agriculture production also increased in the period in which Rohilas were at the power. So one thing is very interesting regarding this Rohila was the alliance which was created at the time of the battle of Mehranpur Katra battle, in which Warren Hastings and Nawab Shujauddaula, they wanted to finish this Sunni power. So it also led to a kind of the sectarian. Some of the arguments of the historian that 18th century is also characterized by the rising sectarian tendency within the Shias and the Sunni. It can also be proved by the manner in which Shujauddaula and then Warren Hastings, they managed to finish this Rohilas. Just set aside Ghulam Qadir. This is a period of short period. Azam. It was a Ghulam Qadir met his end in a very proper. He deserved this end. The manner in which he played havoc in the Mughal court, this man deserves this kind of the end. But then the other Rohilas, Ali Muhammad Khan and those who founded the Rohilas empire in the region of Rampur and then the region of Bareilly, you will see the massive extension of agriculture is taking place. And in terms of agriculture land, used to sustain some of the urban towns also, the production which was agriculture production which was enhanced in this area, and broad jungles were brought down, and many several thousands and thousands of acres of land were brought under the cultivation by these Rohilas. So they had because they were the Rohilas are basically the Afghans. Roh is a place. The term Rohila is based from Roh is a place. In modern Afghanistan. So these ones are always credited with having a kind of a feeling of urban, of having set out the, of having started the process of urbanization. Like Lodis also. There is a very interesting thing that these Lodis are the city builders. Lodi were the city builders, Sikandar Lodi, Behlol Lodi, and then there is a very interesting thing that in the Afwan, because the Lodi are also the Afwans in the 6th century, 5th and 15th and the 16th century, many urban towns emerged. So a kind of a thing was there in the Afwans. It's because of their kind of the tribal nature, they are of the tribal polity, you will see massive urbanization taking place. So Rohilla, that is the reason why the manner, the style in which this regional kingdom was erased from the face of history was a thing which was massively discussed, and it was criticized a lot, and for which Warren Hastings has to face an inquiry in England also, in which he made an alliance with Nawab Shujaat Dowla to erase the empire from the pages of history. So Rohilla estate, of course, and of course the Rampur, the later day creation, it is not an 18th century, but then the Nawabi of Rampur, all those Nawabs of Rampur, they, of course, the Dara Library of Rampur, and the manner in which these Rohillas, Pathan, they also gave impetus to the religious and religious teaching and the madrasa and then libraries. So it is a very interesting thing in the 18th century.
Thank you for this long answer. I'm sorry, I mean, something went wrong on my part and I missed part of your answer. I would just say that there are two scholars who have worked on the Rohillas, which I would want people to read. One is Professor Iqbal Hussain Sahab, and the other is Dr. I.G. Khan. He has also a number of articles on this, especially Iqbal Hussain Sahab, late Iqbal. Both of them are actually late. Their works go a long way to explain the type of question which has been asked. Let us now have the next question by Najmul Hada. Mr. Najmul Hada asks, do you think that 18th century was the century of Shia ascendancy? The cultural efflorescence attributed to this period might be the result of Shia cosmopolitanism and theo-philosophical liberalism.
See, of course, there is a substance into this argument that Shia, it was a period of Shia ascendancy. But then just by having some kind of a Awadh and Lucknow or a little bit of Bengal, where ruling class and those, as a result of the disintegration of Mughal Empire, they happen to be Shi. It cannot be like in this way. It is akin to saying that Sayyid Hussain Nasr had said few years back that 21st century is a Shia century, which is not tenable. Just if someone is having a Shia government in Iraq, or some kind of the political power is being shared by Shiis in Lebanon, the whole century cannot be a Shia century or Shia ascendancy. So saying this term is Shia ascendancy is a kind of some far-fetched idea. But then the cultural efflorescence which is attributed to this period was of course as a result of some kind of the Shia cosmopolitanism, because this is also the period in which massive kind of the churning in the theophilosophical sort of the churning is also going on in the Safavid period, and that has the impact on the Shia scholars, because this is also the period just before few decades or a half a century ago, Mullah Sadra and the philosophy of some of the philosophers, those scholars from Iran, it has also traveled to India and through several Iranian migrants. So a kind of the, of course, Shia cosmopolitanism was there, and this effervescence might be attributed to this kind of the thing. But then saying that it was a period of Shia ascendancy, just by having a Awadh, in which Awadh was a microscopic minority, not a kind of the overwhelming majority. Microscopic minority of the Shi scholars, Shi Ashraf class was there in some of the towns of the Awadh. Or in Bengal, it is very less, even you can't, apart from Murshidabad and some areas of Bengal. So just having a political class, ruling class, Shia, cannot be termed as a Shia citizens. Yeah, and of course, the kind of the liberal ideas which were coming from Iran at that time, I feel that, because at that time, till Nadir Shah's invasion, there had been a very constant cultural interaction. After Nadir Shah and after Ahmad Shah Abdali, a kind of the check started to take place. Now you see, don't see that kind of interaction taking place. But before Nadir Shah, at the time of Nadir Shah invasion, so the kind of the philosophy of and the theory of philosophical liberalism, which Dr. Najmullah Sahab calls, can be attributed to the kind of the fluorescence. Of course, the Marcia is not a kind of the thing which is a kind of the religious thing. It was a kind of the general which was transported from Arabia to Iran and then to India, but in which many things were being discussed. Not only apart from the tragedy of Karbala, it would also reflect so many philosophical things also in the Marcia. So many things which were completely indigenous, Indian terms, Indian terminology, the summer of India, creating a kind of a resemblance with the summer of India, with the hot weather of Iraq at that time, which was later on carried forward by Mir Anis in the 19th century, when he wanted to create a kind of a similarity between the Awadh, the plains of Awadh, to the plains of Karbala. All the heat and the heat wave blowing, khaka ke os aur bhi shabnam bhara hua, sam hoti hote daman sehra bhara hua. This was the kind of thing which was, so it's very indigenous thing imagined.
Dr. Najmul Huda, I won't reject your question or shrug off your question in the same way as Dr. Kazim has done. Yes, something did change. You are quite correct. Whether there was a Shia ascendancy or not, that is debatable. I mean, there I would agree with Kazim that that is problematic. But if you compare the earlier period with this period, late 17th century onwards, there was something which was changing. There was a strong presence of Shias under the Mughals, there's no doubt. A large number of the Iranian nobility were Shias. In fact, Mullah Abdul Qadir Badayuni once notes that during the period of Akbar at Fatehpur Sikri, Akbar once asked that there should be a segregation of Iranis and Turanis in the court so that he might see how many of each of them are there. And Mullah Abdul Qadir Badayuni writes that incidentally, on the side where the Iranians were standing, almost all of them were Shias. They were there. Dr. Huda, it is really very surprising that throughout the period when the Mughal Empire was actually flourishing, from Akbar to Jahangir to Shah Jahan, at least till first half of Shah Jahan's reign, there is hardly any reference, even if the author was a Shia writer, in all the accounts regarding anything which was Shia. No culture is referred to, no tradition is referred to, no ritual is referred to, nothing. Right? Now, Aurangzeb is supposed to be a person who is anti-Shia, just in the same way as he was anti-Hindu. But from the period of his father, Shah Jahan, who started bringing in religion into politics, actually it was not Aurangzeb who brought religion into politics, it was Shah Jahan. And from Shah Jahan's period, we start witnessing the development of certain Shia religious sites. For example, the site of Shah-e-Mardan at Delhi. That started developing from the period of Shah Jahan, and by Aurangzeb's period, it was well established. We have documents which referred to certain madrasas where Shia teachers were teaching and the state was giving grant during the period of Aurangzeb. So from this period onwards, we start finding. And then Kazim rightly pointed out that there was this introduction of Usuli Fiqh into the Indian subcontinent. Many people don't believe when I say that this induction of the Usuli Fiqh started with Qazi Nurullah Shustari during the late 16th century itself. But I feel that Qazi Nurullah Shustari, when he came to the court of Akbar, he was the first who was against Taqiyya. He was against any hiding of the Shia faith and so on and so forth, but he suffered. He also wrote a book of polemics where he tried to retaliate against the Sunni allegations against the Shiites, right? But he was punished. Ultimately, the same thing started developing during the 19th century, not 18th century. One of the best, retaliatory works against Sunni polemics was Abaqatul Anwar, which was written during the 19th century. So if at all, as I said that from late 17th century, the Shias started somehow coming into prominence, but it was by 19th century, if you can say of an ascendancy, it was during that period and not during the 18th century. We may debate over it, but that is what I personally feel. Although I would agree once again with Kazim that whether there was an ascendancy, at least now they were visible. So one can talk about the visibility of the Shias on the political field as well. Najaf Ali Khan, for example, what he was. The whole area of Dargah Quli Khan, the grave of Najaf Ali Khan, Safdarjung, tomb of Safdarjung, that emerged as a Shia center by late 18th century, and by 19th century it was well established. So, Safdarjung was one of those who was related to the Nawabs of Awadh. So there was something where prominence of Shi people were coming in political ascendancy, but during the 19th century. Let us have the next question, please. If there is at all. Is there a next question? Is there any Sufi role influence during this period?
Yes, there was, because the revival of the Jishi Silsila, one of the landmark, one of the defining during the 18th century, was that the revival of the Chishti Sufi Silsila, which has gone to back in the background, which was in the background for the last several two or three centuries, with the emergence of Shah Fakhruddin and then Shah Kalimullah. So apart from this, of course, the Naqshbandi was there. No one can deny, and the debate which was taking place between the Wujudi and Shahudi type groups, whether to go for Hama Ust or Hama Azust, these are the two things were hotly debated in the various Khanqahs. I discussed in my talk how the Urs of several Sufi shrines in Delhi become a kind of a repository and become a kind of a crucible for the cultural interaction in those Muslim, Shia, Sunni and whatnot. The Sharif procession. So the Sufis had a very, even the Sama Mafil, Shah Alam, Alamgir and then Ahmad Shah, they would also barge into any Sama Mafil and attend this. So Sufistic role was there, of course, but the Naqshband, so far as the thing is, the Naqshbandi role cannot be denied. The Naqshbandi influence because of the two very, very prominent men who never left Delhi, who remained in Delhi, Khaja Mir Dard and Mirza Jahan Jana. They played a very crucial role in the revival of, in the propagation of the Naqshbandi silsila also. So the role of Sufism was there in 18th century. It is marked by.
You also spoke about it during the course of your lecture. I mean, you did mention that. Before we take up the next question, let me also just add briefly. I'm sorry. And that is that, all those who were interested in the question which Dr. Huda had asked, please go and look at one of the previous lectures which had been delivered through our platform, the lecture delivered by Dr. Sajjad Rizvi, where he talked about the Shia networks. During the 18th, 19th centuries and how, what was happening during this period. So I think that lecture would also clear many of the doubts which may be rising in our minds, including Dr. Kazim's. Let us have the next question. Lakshmi Kant Mishra, if agency theory is given due attention, then 18th century may be seen as a stage where several actors tried to pull in different directions for different purposes. Regional histories need to be studied seriously. Can you throw some light? Yes. I think, that's a conversation, and I think, that we will take it as a suggestion, and a whole lecture is needed as a response to that. So I would request Dr. Kazim to desist from throwing some light, if at all, let us have a lecture on this topic. Next one is by, probably let it be the last, Muhammad Aftab Alam. Can the phenomena of culture and literary rejuvenation in case of political disintegration be generalized in the context of world history, not only in the case of Indian history? Is there any theoretical connection between the two?
In case of world history, exactly, because I will have to see it from this aspect also, but in case of the medieval world, medieval Islamic world, the land revenue empire, the gunpowder empire, there is a kind of the literary and cultural rejuvenation taking place in this period. I've been working, and I have been teaching the courses where recently I came across several articles and several books in which there is a kind of the in kind of, at least in Safavid Iran and even in the Ottomans, this is the period of the 18th century in which due to the contact with the colonial powers, a massive sea change was taking place. There is no denying this fact in this way. Like I discussed in the lecture, in the talk, how the arrival of Napoleon, of course, many things were taking place in Egypt. You can't simply say that and one day Napoleon arrived and everything changed for Egypt. But it was one of the important turning points in the history of the Egypt and in the history of the Syria, and then later on to the Arab world. The arrival of Napoleon, and then finally how did Muhammad Ali Pasha, the great Albanian general, the regent of the man who was ruling on behalf of the Ottoman Empire, how they reacted and how they tried to implement so many things, European reforms. So many things happened in the Egypt and the Arab part of Arab world. The same thing happened in the Iranian part also. The Safavid period, the very interesting period, the latter period, and the many things, many development, cultural, literary, in field of societies taking place in Iran. And the Ottoman Empire, there is no need to say how, of course, politically it was getting weaker. But then the area which was under the subjugation of the Ottoman Empire, that was intact till the 18th century. It was only after the 18th century, 19th, then when the colonial powers, England, Russia, and all those people started to scramble for the areas of Ottoman Empire, only then kind of the political disintegration took place. But then in terms of cultural and literary development, you see massive kind of the buildings, building construction, in terms of science, in terms of surgery, in terms of ophthalmology, and in terms of the rise and growth of Turkish literature, Ottoman Empire. So it was a kind of the political disintegration coupled with the literary and cultural kind of the rejuvenation was taking place in several parts of the Gunpowder Empire, even in the Mughal Empire also. So that is my
well, let me now thank Dr. Kazim once again for really a very good presentation by Dr. Ali Kazim. Before we close, as to be expected, I would like to give certain of my, you know, unlettered comments, because 18th century is not my field. But still, whatever I have, read about it, I would agree with Dr. Kazim that Dargah Quli Khan and Siyarul Mutakhirin are two very important works which should be consulted by anyone interested in the study of 18th century. In fact, I haven't gone through Siyarul Mutakhirin in the same fashion as I have gone through Dargah Quli Khan. I have read portions of Siyarul Mutakhirin, but as far as Dargah Quli Khan is concerned, for two reasons, I went through it because it's a fascinating account, and secondly, it's a very brief account. So I was able to go through it from cover to cover. Now, also present in various forms of translations. It is there in Urdu, it is there in English. One thing which becomes very, very apparent by a reading of Dargah Quli Khan is that at least till 1740, we don't know what happened after that, because the account is being written somewhere around 1740, just at the time when there was an invasion of Delhi, at Delhi. So what a vibrant society he encounters. You know, all this talk about Sufism and Shiism developing, one of the reasons behind this type of, you know, theory of efflorescence of both these Sufism and Shiism possibly is based on what Dargah Quli Khan writes. On each and every street and chauraha in Delhi, there are, you know, Sufi mehfils going on, qawwalis are being mentioned, you know, sessions which are being held at dargahs, at the graves of the saints, Hindu saints, Muslim saints, all type of, you know, Sufi silsilas which are there, they are being mentioned. Vibrant places where to be expected that much of dance and singing is also taking place. I mean, it's a vibrant fairs and festivals are being organized. Similarly, he also mentions the period of Muharram when you know, on street corners, members are set up, and from the members, tazkirs are taking place. You know, the majalis are being recited. He also goes on to name a large number of marsiya khwans, those who were reciting marsiyas. So, in a way, I mean, all this type of information actually is not available for the early period. What was happening in Delhi earlier on, we just don't know. Whether all this started taking place only during the period when the author Dargah Quli Khan was visiting this place in 1740s, or were these things happening even before that? I suspect they were happening before that. I would draw the attention of the audience to the fact that Mullah Abdul Qadir Badayuni gives reference to the Marsiya recitation in the Delhi houses during the period when Humayun was reigning, before Akbar. He names and cites a number of verses from a Marcia, which he says were recited from house to house in the, you know, gullies of Delhi. This is what he says. So, you know, so possibly the what had changed was that now that type of literature is present before us, so that we interpret it. One thing which I would like to say is, although because the topic was on culture, it was on literary and you know, cultural aspects, but I wish that we could have also discussed, because we are discussing, we almost discussed everything. So why leave out the Marathas and their depredations which took place during the 18th century? That is an aspect which I think has been left out. But as somebody says, that everything cannot be summed up in 1 hour. And I am really thankful to Dr. Ali Kazim that although we are reaching now 2 hours, but that is because of the discussions. He finished his lecture in only 1 hour. Thank you very much. And I wish him all the luck. It was a beautiful presentation. And I hope that in future also, you will keep on contributing in the same fashion. Let me also tell the public who are watching that very, very recently, Dr. Ali Kazim has been appointed as an associate professor in the Department of History. First, he suffered from COVID. We were on the verge of missing him. And now we have him back with a flourish as a future professor in the Department of History. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.